Well, you heard it here first. We're looking for more talks and stuff, so don't be shy. Tell George you want to talk here. Actually, that kind of is a nice dovetail into my talk, trying to figure out ways of getting more people to talk at things like NYC BUG. So hello, everyone in person, and hello, everyone who is watching me. Are we live?
We are not live.
All right, so in the recording, this is going to make me sound like I'm a crazy person. We are, in fact, not live yet. But that's OK. I'll just keep talking. Eventually, we'll be live, or it'll be up after the talk. So welcome to my talk called, Once Again, I've Done Something No One Asked For, which is tongue-in-cheek. I actually, when I was making the slides, realized I actually misquoted myself in the title of the slide. The actual quote is, I did yet another thing no one asked for. Sometimes it's better to be lucky than good. So when I was first asked to come up with a talk for tonight, I was thinking about something in terms of advocacy. I was thinking something in terms that would be fun or funny or different or just, I don't know why anyone would want to do this with the BSDs and talk to you about all that stuff. And then CrowdStrike happens. So now it can also be a talk about, you know, perhaps we should think better about not just advocating for the BSDs, but what is the actual goal of advocating for the BSDs, right? If you've been around NYC BUG for any length of time, you've probably heard somebody talk to you about monocultures and monocultures not exactly being a great thing for really any community, right? You think about biological monocultures, not all that good for ecosystems. And we're beginning to see that perhaps technological monocultures, not so good for tech ecosystems either, right? Anyone else besides us affected by CrowdStrike? No one? So like, none of you are using Windows? I envy all of you. I envy all of you. So I'm gonna chat with you mostly about my prospects in porting the Oracle Developer Studio compilers and the new Intel 1 API compilers to both FreeBSD and NetBSD. I will talk about interesting challenges along the way. I'll talk about people's reaction to what it is I was doing, because you would think, why in the world would you want to port Sun's old compilers to FreeBSD? And you probably don't, but it is an interesting journey into what can be done on these systems. So George actually probably had a nicer introduction than I can give for myself. As he mentioned, I'm a professor over at RPI in the ITWS program. I'm the director of our Cybersecurity Research Center, the RCC. I've been doing this OpenBSD thing for a while. Had my account since 2013, but been around the scene since at least 2005, maybe a little bit earlier. I talk at NYC BUG a lot. This is actually my 9th talk at NYC BUG over the years. I've never participated in the Olympics, for those of you who are watching the Olympics. I do watch them a lot, though, but never actually got to participate. Future me, next life me, perhaps. As George mentioned, right, thinking about advocacy, thinking about how do we talk about the BSDs to larger communities in 2024? Yes, you know, we could have funny talks like Jason Dixon's talk and the other talks like BSD is dying, Henning's talk, right? OpenBSD sucks, but I also like the approach of Michael Lucas back, if any of you were here for NYCBSDCon 2014, he gave a talk. I don't remember if BSD Books was at that one or his follow-up was at that one, but he's given a couple of these advocacy talks, right, talking about why it is we need to talk about the BSDs over, oh yeah, look at that. There you go, we got a shirt. I couldn't even tell you where mine is. I wish I knew where mine was. I would have worn it tonight, but other things at BSDs, right? We need blog posts, we need YouTube videos, we of course need bug meetings. I would posit that everyone here has something weird that they do with their computers that is worth talking about. So I'm gonna talk to you about some weird stuff that I've been doing with my computers lately. So raise your hand if you've ever used Solaris. I guess Illumos is the modern open source version. Anyone use Sun's old compilers on those systems? One person, the one person who I would expect. It turns out, believe it or not, Oracle will still give you their old, well, I guess, updated versions of Sun's compilers. They have not been updated since 2017. Take that for what you will, but they do still work. You can still download them. They don't call them Sun anymore, I guess, after Oracle bought them out. It's now Oracle Developer Studio. It is, in fact, a complete C and C++, and I think Fortran developer environment. Right, you can go right on their website, and you can download it. Not only can you download the current release, 12.6, they'll let you download old releases all the way back to, I think, 12.3. So there's a number of releases that you can download for it. Of course, if you had to guess what operating systems they offer downloads for, what operating systems might you, guess? Yeah, Solaris and Linux are the ones that they offer downloads for. Obviously, FreeBSD not on that list, but it does mean that we can't try. You end up having to download, I found this out the hard way, the tar file. They do have a patching system that you can use like Oracle's package manager to help update. That, of course, does not exist on the BSD, so you gotta download the tar file. You lose out on the updates. I don't think any updates are coming. I don't think they're gonna be updating it anytime soon, but you can go ahead and download it. The key here for the BSDs, and something that I don't hear enough about, I don't think, but it's definitely something worth talking about, particularly for FreeBSD and NetBSD, not so much OpenBSD, is the Linuxulator, right? So on FreeBSD, on NetBSD, it takes like three lines in your terminal, and you can be up and running Linux binaries as if they were running on your actual machine. This is for FreeBSD, just a quick sysrc to turn on Linux, start the service, and then you do need to download the binaries for the library so that you have the Linux version of the shared libraries to run the tools. For the compiler, it just needs the base set of tools. It also needs ELF. It uses something from libelf. I'm not quite sure what, but it panicked on me without it, and then I installed it, and then it worked, so figure. That must be the winning combination. In terms of installing it, once you have the tar file, once you extract it, you put it right into /op/oracle. For those of you who've ever used the Linuxulator, both on FreeBSD and on NetBSD, they kind of isolate all the Linux stuff into their own kind of subdirectories. I think on NetBSD it's /emule/linux. I forget exactly what it is on FreeBSD, but it's something that's isolated from the rest of your system. I found it's easier for this just to ignore the isolation of the Linux system and just throw it directly into like literally /opt/oracle so that your C compiler ends up living in opt oracle developer studio bin cc. And then if you have all that, you can run that command and you will in fact get a C compiler. Of course, it's going to be a C compiler that targets Linux, not one that targets FreeBSD. So that brings us to a choose your own adventure slide. You can take the easy way out and just pretend your system is Linux and just say, hey, I know this compiler is going to install Linux binaries and can work with Linux binaries. And so I'm just gonna build Linux binaries and then I'll use the Linuxulator to run those things and all is good and everybody wins, right? So the easy way to do that is to install your Linux headers, install the GNU bin utils targeting Linux, which is a package that you can just install, and then you're good. And then you can just run the compiler on the C code that you want to run it on, generate Linux binaries, and the Linuxulator will run them, and everyone is happy. I am really bad at just choosing the easy way. I only ever choose the hard way. So I wanted to figure out, could I convince this compiler to actually output native FreeBSD binaries so that I could turn off the Linuxulator and the binaries that I have would still actually run on the system? And it turns out the hard way is kind of being really charitable to myself. This was a lot of headache way. I actually dug into a lot of really interesting things about FreeBSD and how that particular compiler works. So I need to figure out how to get the compiler to know about FreeBSD, to know something about the dynamic linker, to know something about user bin LD, fix up headers, and a whole bunch of stuff along the way. So if we are going to take the hard way, for any of you who have ever dug into compilers or dug into kind of lower level, how do you actually get these programs to run on your machine? How does object code actually get loaded into memory and execute? One of the things that you'll stumble upon pretty quickly is your dynamic linker. On Linux, on AMD 64, it usually lives in /lib64/ld-linux-x86-64.so.2. On FreeBSD, however, it lives on /libexec/ld-elf.so.1. I forget exactly where it lives in NetBSD, but I think it's something similar to FreeBSD. Every system's gonna have a dynamic linker. They'll all live in slightly different places. And the only dynamic linker that the Sun compiler knows about is the Linux one. In fact, it actually hard codes in that string /lib64/ld-linux-x86-64.so.2. So we can write a really quick C program to just see what the compiler is actually going to do when you try to give it a compile. So a very simple true.c program, right? Something that's just gonna return zero, take no arguments. The --pound sign flag on the Sun compiler is how you get it to spit out all of the information that it's doing as it's doing its compilation, right? It's --v on GNU style compilers, --hash or --pound sign on the Sun compilers. And it will give you a whole lot of information. Too much that I could not fit it on a slide. It turns out, however, the preprocessor step mostly works. We'll talk about that in a little bit. The compilation step kind of just works. It has its own optimization step that's actually its own independent binary, and that just works. And the linker step just works. Again, assuming that you're targeting Linux, we're trying not to target Linux, so that is predominantly where our headache is. So what do we learn? Kind of reading through all that information, we learn that user bin LD is hard-coded. So when you actually go to link a program with the Sun compiler, it will actually just call /user/bin/LD, and that is hard-coded into the compiler itself. It also has some hard-coded flags. It has a dynamic linker flag that is specifically pointing at Linux's dynamic linker. There's also a --Y flag, and then there's a whole bunch of paths after that. That LLD, for those of you who don't know, FreeBSD, modern FreeBSD, has moved to LLVM's linker, LLD as user bin LD. And LLD simply just does not understand that Y flag. So it gives you a whole bunch of errors saying, I have no idea what you're trying to tell me with this Y flag. There is also a --QY flag that LLD also does not understand. Again, it complains to you when it sees the QY flag. It can't find libc, so it says, I have no idea where to find your libraries. It uses a whole bunch of Linux-specific C startup files that are all hard-coded into your invocation. It uses a whole bunch of Linux preprocessor defines that are also hard-coded into your invocation. However, the good news is, if you issued it just the lowercase c flag and just got your object file, you could go on to link it with FreeBSD's tools, and that would kind of just work, provided that like you didn't like define FreeBSD somewhere in your code and actually depend on that particular definition. So we're kind of there. Kind of not there, but kind of there. So how do we deal with this? Well, the first obvious thing when it comes to preprocessor defines is you can just define your own things right on the command line, right? You can just say -d, and then in this case, I was using FreeBSD 14, so you can say FreeBSD equals 14, and we discover that this works. You do, in fact, have this added into your preprocessor. Of course it does. This works for like every single C compiler out there. The capital D flag is how you add additional preprocessor defines. However, we have Linux, we have two versions of Linux and one version of GNU Linux all hard-coded into the preprocessor invocation. So we do need to find a way to remove those invocations. Like many C compilers, you have the capital U flag, which will remove options from your preprocessor. One of the things that is really nice about the Sun compiler, at least, is whatever you define on the command line takes precedence over what is hard-coded, no matter where it ends up in the ordering as it spits out on the command line if you were to use the dash pound flag. So anything on the command line kind of wins over what is predefined within the invocations. So all you need to do is add those three undefines on your command line, add your FreeBSD define, and you have essentially told at least the preprocessor, hey, we are not on a Linux system, we are in fact on a FreeBSD system. So that takes care of one thing. Another thing, and I think this is unique to LLD, I think the GNU linkers actually hard code, or at least you can give it to it when at compile time, a list of directories to automatically search through. And LLD does not have that option as far as I know. But you can simply add the capital L flag pointing to user lib to tell it, hey, this is where my libc lives. You should go look in there when you are looking for libc. Because I discovered that what you put on the command line takes precedence over what is hard-coded, you can also simply add another flag to tell the Sun compiler where FreeBSD's dynamic linker is, and that will just magically override it. Again, when you actually look at what the compiler is doing, it may look like it's out of order, but it is in fact overwriting what has been hard-coded within the invocations. So with kind of a little bit of massaging work, and I effectively built a shell script to kind of do all this stuff for me because I didn't really want to write this out by hand every single time. And you can also, you know, give it a nice name like SunCC or something like that. But with a couple of command line flags, you can get much, much closer to convincing the Sun compiler that, yes?
You say on the command line, what is the actual command that you're running? Is it like CC?
It is opt oracle developer studio bin cc, yes. There are some additional missing defines that just don't exist in the Sun headers that FreeBSD absolutely relies on to process its own headers. Things like size of long, size of pointer, size of size t, and size of pointer div t. If you don't have these things defined somewhere, your C compiler basically just errors out immediately because it can't process its own system define, its own system headers. If you look in Clang and you give Clang the lowercase d capital M dash E to just spit out all of its defines, you will find these in its list of defines that are built into at least FreeBSD's version of Clang. Again, if you don't have them, you pretty quickly run into problems processing your own FreeBSD headers. And we also needed some additional attribute tags. FreeBSD has a double underscore aligned, which the Sun compiler was not happy with, but the Sun compiler does understand GNU-style attribute flags. And it turns out that double underscore aligned is just an alias for the GNU-style attribute aligned. And there's also a simcompat. I assume this is something with backwards compatibility for earlier versions of FreeBSD. I couldn't find a GNU attribute that mapped to. I didn't find that it was very useful, so I just kind of effectively removed it. Just set it equal to blank, so if it gets seen anywhere in the headers, it just removes it from compilation. In terms of linker flags, I found out that LLD did once understand the QY flag. If I remember correctly, it adds some sort of information to your binaries, like what linker was actually used to link this thing. But at some point, this was removed. However, all LLD did if it saw QY was just ignore it, so we weren't really like getting very much out of that flag anyway. And the Y flag is a Solaris-specific flag. As best I can tell, it's basically the capital L flag. It might get processed earlier than the capital L flag, if I was reading the documentation correctly. But it's basically the capital L flag. So that brings us to an impasse. Again, we can take the easy way or the hard way. And spoiler alert, I did not take the hard way this time. I gave up on the hard way, and I took the easy way. Because the hard way would be to send patches to the LLVM project, to FreeBSD, to everyone, and say, hey, I would like to reteach LLD about the QY flag and I would like to teach LLD about the capital Y flag. And I don't think they'd be too happy with me if I started doing stuff like that, as silly as it is, as much as I might be amused by it. I don't think anyone else would be amused by it. So I did not take the hard way. I, in fact, took the easy way. And you actually have two different options for the easy way. Easy way number one, which is what I started with, was simply to just replace user bin LD with the GNU linker from ports. Right, so if you install the FreeBSD native bin utils, you'll get a user local bin LD. If you just copy that over to user bin LD, then you can just use the Sun compiler, and the GNU version of LD does understand QY and Y and does the right thing with them, and then all is good. But I tried that, and I mentioned that, and some FreeBSD people got mad at me. They said that if I did that and I broke something else, I'd have to pick up both pieces. And so I figured, why make them mad? Why make them angry? Why ruin a good thing? So I tried another option. They didn't like this one either all that much, but it's a little bit closer to something that I could maybe sort of argue. Write a script that you install into user bin LD. That simply is going to scan your command line invocations, ignore the QY flag, and just convert dash Y to dash L. You can do this with a simple shell script. You don't actually lose LLD if you do this. The actual LLD binary is installed to user bin ld.lld, if I remember correctly. So you don't actually lose the binary. You're just putting a script in between to kind of intercept these flags. And that way you're still using LLD. People were less mad at me about this second one, so I ultimately end up choosing this second one. But either any of these three ways would, in theory, work. Just how much time and effort do you actually want to put into this problem? Additionally, there were header issues that needed to be dealt with. So the Sun compiler will install its own headers that I guess we could say are tuned to Linux, if you're installing the Linux version of the Sun compiler, but is mostly compatible with FreeBSD. The two main issues on the compiler side for the Sun compiler headers were they had one header that was basically always included that assumes you had the GNU features.h header somewhere in your system headers, which FreeBSD does not, so we just had to remove that. As far as I can tell, it didn't actually do anything useful with features.h, so it was kind of just sitting there, and removing it just kind of worked. And then additionally, the Sun C compiler appears to not use the GNU style VA args. It has its own version of VA args, as I see some people raise their eyebrows at me when they hear this. So we just forced the Oracle Studio VA args to be used. And you got to do the same thing on the FreeBSD side. You had to put in some headers in the standard I/O and some other places to say, hey, if we're using the Sun compiler has its own define, it's double underscore Sun Pro C. You could say, hey, if we're using the Sun Pro compiler, don't use the GNU style built-in VA args. Use Sun's VA args instead. This does kind of just work. I'm not going to recommend you start mixing and matching object code that is using different kinds of VA args. That's probably a recipe for disaster. But as long as you keep things kind of in their own boxes, it kind of works just fine. And I don't know if this is something that is a bug in the Sun compiler or something the FreeBSD people would want to look into. But for some reason, if you ever included xlocal/underscore ctype.h with the Sun compiler, it didn't pick up runetype.h. That could be the Sun compiler doing something wrong, and the FreeBSD headers are probably just fine. But it is something interesting to note that, at least for the Sun compiler, it couldn't figure out where runetype.h was, and therefore, if you ever did include that file, you got a nice little error message. Another thing that was kind of like a deal breaker that you just had to do is while you do get C startup routines with your compiler, ooh, look at that. We got some mood lighting going on. They're Linux versions of the C startup routines. And these were all hard-coded into the compiler invocations, the linker invocation in particular. So I just took the free BSDC startup routines and copied them over to where they were expected to be for the Sun compiler. And this actually just worked. So CRT1.0moved into CRT1X.0, CRTI moved into CRTI, and CRTN moved into CRTN. If you've ever installed a modern version of FreeBSD, particularly 64-bit FreeBSD, you've probably seen that you have the option at installation time to do a multilib thing where you can have the 32-bit library so that you can have both 32-bit binaries and 64-bit binaries. Solaris also has that, also baked into their OS. The Sun compiler does have an M32 flag, similar to GCC and Clang, that will output 32-bit code if you run with that flag. You can just retrace your steps with your C startup routine and retrace your step to where to find your system libraries, /user/lib32 instead of /user/lib. And that will just magically work with the multi-lib system. So I end up having to write a fairly involved shell script that would read in your invocation, figure out the flags that you were giving it, and then kind of modify different invocations, right? If you put M32, tell it to go look for the 32-bit libraries, things like that. But it does work, and you can, in fact, compile both 64-bit code and 32-bit code on FreeBSD with the Sun compiler. And if you do all this, you get this magic output if you run file on your programs. And this is exactly what you'd expect to see if compiling with a native FreeBSD compiler. You should expect it to see the correct interpreter location, libexec ld-elf.so.1, for FreeBSD. At the time I was using 14.0, so for FreeBSD 14.0, FreeBSD style, and you can then turn off the Linux shellator and it works. And it is just as if you had compiled with GCC or Clang, which of course is a whole lot of headache just to build some C code, considering you already have a C compiler built into FreeBSD. It's called CC. You can just type in CC and you have this wonderful C compiler. But it does work. You can actually compile at least moderately complex code with it. You can download a version of Bash that will run on FreeBSD 14 that is entirely compiled with the Sun compiler using this system. And it does, in fact, work. And to prove that it was built with the Sun compiler, if you run readelfx and look for the comment section of that binary, you will see the output, a nice little message saying that it was built with the Oracle Developer Studio compiler. So this does work. Raise your hand if you think this was a good use of my time. As you can see, everyone was excited by this. The first question I got was, I gotta ask why. Very fair question. This is also my favorite response. I did not grow up using Solaris. So actually, Linux was my first Unix, and then shortly thereafter, I'd moved to the BSDs, so I got to skip all the Sun stuff in my lifetime. So I have no nostalgia for this stuff. I just thought, I can get that to run, and if I get that to run, I can tell other people that I got this to run, and they can all look at me like I'm crazy. And here we are. I got a lot of responses like this. Like, this is a weird thing to do. I'm also so very happy that all these random people online are concerned about how I use my time and want me to use my time for better stuff. I do feel the love from all of them. However, I hope, that pointing to things like this tells us something about communicating more broadly about why the BSDs, and the fact that there really isn't a technical reason why we can't be using the BSDs, right? The reason we don't have a Sun Studio compiler that is ready to go on the BSDs is social. It is not technical, because lo and behold, you can do it. I did spend all the time doing it. And I think a lot of those BSD is dying, BSD need books, right? Other BSD advocacy talks try to sort of point this out, that a lot of the things that people think, rightly or wrongly, about the BSDs are almost never technical in nature. They are social in nature. And doing silly things like this is a reminder that there is no technical reason why we can't have these things. This is about to get a little bit worse, not better, so stick with me. All right, let's talk about something that everyone loves, compilers. So let's talk about another C compiler, the Intel C compiler. Believe it or not, I'm gonna take credit for this, I killed the FreeBSD port. There was a FreeBSD port of the Intel C compiler for many, many, many years. It was version 8.1. Does anyone want to take a guess in what year version 8.1 of the Intel compiler came out?
1996.
It's very close. It was 2004. It was 2004. So this port had been sitting in the ports tree since 2004. I don't even know if it worked or not. I will say that I made a blog post about this in, I want to say early March, and a week later, this deprecated notice showed up in the FreeBSD ports. So I'd like to say that I killed this port. Thank you to the FreeBSD developers who are reading my blog. I much appreciate it. I spent a lot of time writing those blog posts, so I'm glad to know that someone, in fact, reads it. And they do make a note there that the current Clang-based Intel compiler seems to work, which I have to assume that they got from me, because there's no one else clamoring for a need for this other than myself. So I'll take credit for this. And this is another point where we will see there is no technical reason why FreeBSD, NetBSD, and actually with the Intel compiler, even OpenBSD, can't have this available. Just that no one from Intel has been building with this. So installation. Anyone want to take a guess what the installation for this is? It's a gross GUI program. When you go to install it, it's a gross GUI program that I could not get to run on FreeBSD. So I gave up, and I fired up WSL on this laptop, and I installed it on Linux, and then I put it in a tarball, and I copied it over.
And it's available for like Linux and Windows?
Yes.
And it's only a GUI install?
I believe they do have a terminal-based installer, but it also just didn't work on FreeBSD. I don't think for any technical reason, I think I was probably just missing something. For some reason, the installation for the Intel compiler, I think this is the one that freaks out if you don't have, no, that was a someone. So the someone freaks out if you don't have G++ installed. I forget the reason why it didn't work. Like, it would look like it's working, it would seem to actually finish installing it and then be like, whoops, I didn't install. So gross GUI installer. I ran it on my WSL copy on this laptop, tarballed it up, put it on the FreeBSD machine and extracted it. So again, Linux binaries. So the Linux emulator is installed, but it's kind of like the Sun compiler. I ignored the kind of separation that it does for Linux binaries and I just threw it in /opt. This is where Intel expects it to live, so I just stuck with what Intel expects. So it does expect it to live at like opt Intel 1 API compiler latest bin ICX for the C compiler or ICPX for the C++ compiler. If you run the version flag, this should look very familiar. If you've ever run the version flag on Clang, this is basically what you get with Clang and actually almost the exact same format. Instead of saying Intel here, it'll say Clang, I'll have target just like this, thread model just like this, install dir. I don't think that's a configuration file for Clang, but these things are like identical to what you would see on Clang. So, could it be this easy? Could it be as easy as just lying to the Intel compiler and say, hey, I'd like you to target FreeBSD? If you do that, it does appear to recognize that you are running on, or at least you've asked for a target of FreeBSD, and it appears to know what the FreeBSD target is. Now, on one hand, it could just be copying and pasting what I put in the flag down in the target model, but it actually turns out it does actually know what the FreeBSD target is. If you give it a target it truly doesn't understand, it actually will complain to you and say, I don't know what that target is. So it does actually recognize FreeBSD as a target. So fingers crossed, could this one be easy? Could we write a simple wrapper script or a wrapper binary that simply tells the compiler to target FreeBSD, simply add that target flag to the invocation? Anyone want to take a guess before I ruin the surprise?
No.
It is in fact that easy. All you have to do to get the Intel compiler to produce native FreeBSD binaries is to tell it, hey, my target is FreeBSD. And it will just happily make you binaries that actually target FreeBSD. This is kind of more kind of lending credence to the fact that like this is just Clang on the front end with an Intel custom backend. At least we think it's an Intel custom backend. But this does just work. So if you're not familiar with this language, this is the D language. This is by a guy named Walter Bright. Any of you have played Empire? He's also the guy that made the Empire computer game. You can write a very short program. All this program does is call the compiler from the correct location, add target if you're on FreeBSD 14, FreeBSD 14, if you're on FreeBSD 13, FreeBSD 13, and add the FNO built-in flag. Why the FNO built-in flag? The reason for this is because if you let the Intel compiler do its own thing, it will try to use its own libraries that come with the compiler, and they are all Linux, and they assume not only that you run Linux, they assume that you're actually running glibc. So if you're running Muscle or any other kind of third party, or I guess non-GNU C library, this won't even work. It assumes that you're using glibc to be the backing for its own custom library functions. So if you say fno built-in, that just overrides Clang's usage of Intel's custom libraries. And then you just spit out all the other arguments as we're put on the command line. And you're good. And it actually does just work. So you can just install it. I installed it on my machine as user bin ICX. And I can just type in ICX, and I can use it just like I use Clang, and I can get native FreeBSD binaries as if I compiled them with the actual base system's Clang. Allegedly, this is all open source. So if someone out there wants to port and throw them up on the mailing list, ports of ICX for all the different BSDs, thank you ahead of time. I'm not going to do it. So whoever's going to do it, thank you ahead of time. So can you build anything useful with the Intel compiler? Because I hate myself and only want to do things the hard way, my first thought was, what if we built the kernel with it? What if we just, you know, built the FreeBSD kernel, see what happens? It turns out you can do that, and you can successfully build the FreeBSD kernel with a big asterisk that I'll mention in a second, with the Intel compiler. All you gotta do is grab the sources, go into the source directory. The makefile doesn't know what kind of compiler ICX is, so you do have to say both that CC equals ICX and compiler type equals Clang, and then you can just run the standard make build kernel and sit around and wait for a little bit, and in a couple of minutes, you will get a nice little output that says, I've successfully built the kernel. Here you go. And then I decided, well, I'm gonna hose this system anyway. Let's install and see how long it takes it to crash. I totally did not expect this kernel to work. I figured I would install it, I'd reboot the machine, it would crash hilariously. I didn't want to go dig through Intel's custom backend to figure out what is wrong, so I'll just give up. Turns out it works. Turns out I rebooted the machine. That compiler, the backend, they are different. It does make a kernel about 3% larger than what you get from what FreeBSD ships. But it rebooted just fine. It loaded up my X11 environment just fine. I could do everything I wanted just fine, except I couldn't run ICX anymore because for some reason, it does not compile kernel modules correctly. And I do not know the reason behind that. These are actually the errors that you get if you try to load anything.
So you were just using generic kernel, there was nothing?
No, nothing changed. Yep, just nothing the generic. Okay,
so there's gotta be some hooks for KLD, right?
Yeah, or something that the backend just miscompiled. This would take a little bit more work to actually go and hunt down. Potentially limited utility. I don't know if anyone's gonna run off and actually figure it out. That'll be my next talk here. I spent 4 months, but I finally figured out what was wrong with this, and now I'm here to tell you about more silly stuff that I've been doing. But you can get pretty close. I mean, if you don't depend on kernel modules, you can have a perfectly working FreeBSD system, at least a FreeBSD kernel, compiled with the Intel compiler. Next on my list is to do the rest of user land, but I'm at a weird impasse. I can't run ICX on my new system, so I can't build user land. So, yeah, exactly. It's telling me to stop. However, remember that time I talked about how I built the Sun compiler and had that run on FreeBSD? I'm not good at giving up. Like, I'm just not good at it. So, this is kind of tongue-in-cheek. This is designed to be funny. I do weird things with my computer. This is what I do when I'm bored. You know, the students, you know, they get me all, you know, I spend all my days with them and I go home and I'm like, I just don't want to think about anything, and this is what I do. Take that for what you will. So, again, particularly with Intel, there is no technical reason why we can't have the Intel compiler on all the BSDs. There really isn't a technical reason why Intel couldn't make a version of their support libraries that use another C library as its backend, right? Instead of assuming glibc, it would, I assume, be fairly easy for them to target FreeBSD libc or NetBSD libc or maybe some other, you know, compat or shim library in the middle that smooths over all those differences between glibc, muscle, and all the BSD libcs that are out there. Not technical, social. So, in a world where we had a very, very serious look about the dangers of monocultures with CrowdStrike, how do we communicate that this monoculture problem isn't a thing that just affects Windows, right? I could very easily, just as easily, imagine some sort of kernel hook or some sort of proprietary program that runs on Linux, that a bad update goes out, that hundreds of millions, if not billions, of Linux servers download and then fail to reboot. That'll never happen. I don't think it's unreasonable to think that it's possible. Yeah, like with 8.5 million computers. So I think now more than ever, we really do need to communicate the value of a robust, resilient landscape of operating systems beyond just Windows, macOS, and Linux. You know, there will be more and more attacks on machines. There will be inevitably another CrowdStrike. And we'll be lucky next time if it's only 8.5 million machines. And with a little bit of future planning with breaking up monocultures, I think we can get really, really far. So, moving forward, how can you participate in kind of bringing out that advocacy for the BSDs, talking about the need, the ever-increasing need for this kind of diversity in our computing landscape? The very first thing you can do is be ridiculous. Like, I love when people ask me, why in the world do you do the things that you do? I love people who are concerned so very personally about the way I choose to spend my free time. It tells you something about the way that they view what it is that we're doing, right? Kind of the, maybe not the humor, but kind of the underlying points of, you know, the original meme about BSD is dying. Forget about the talks that then lambasted, right? Part of the original underlying message of the BSDs are dying is this is something that we shouldn't be using anymore, or this is something that is worth kind of laying out on the wayside. And I simply don't think that that is true. I think the BSDs have a really robust and fun and interesting community who see computing differently than other communities see computing. And those different ways of viewing these shared problems that we all face isn't a hindrance to solving our problems, it's an asset to solving our problems. So all of us, I assume, maybe I'm wrong, I'm willing to be wrong. Do all of us do weird things with computers? Am I the only one who thinks that like I'm gonna waste my time doing stuff like this? Please tell me I'm not the only one. People online, someone send something to IRC saying, I also do weird stuff like this. Make me feel better, right? Even if you're not doing weird stuff like this, there is something that you are doing that can be done with the BSDs that is worth talking about. If it is worth talking about me getting the Sun compiler to run native binaries on FreeBSD, whatever you're doing, it's A, far more interesting, and B, actually worth sharing. So get people to ask you these kinds of questions. Like, I gotta ask why. Then you'll probably know that you're on the right track. Have fun, right? If we're not having, I get that people like do this for a job, it's how you get a paycheck, it's how you put food on your table and all the other good stuff, but like, have fun. If you're not having fun with this stuff, right, why are we doing this? One of the things I get all the time, not from my students so much, but from other kind of staff and faculty around RPI, is that I genuinely look like I am having fun with what I'm doing. And I am genuinely having fun with what I'm doing. It's a lot. We all work very hard. But I'm having fun. Like, I'm having a good time standing up here telling you about this ridiculous stuff that I'm doing. And I promise you, if you've never been in my position where you're up here talking to a group of people, telling them about the weird stuff that you've been doing, try it. It is fun. I promise you it's fun. Nice bug is a good place to do it. No one's gonna like come yell at you and tell you you did a bad job. Right? Give yourself that opportunity to have that first talk where you just get up here and be like, BSD is great, this is what I use it for, and this is why I think you should use it too. If you're not gonna give talks right in front of an audience, make blog posts. Right? Blog posts are not only a good way to share what you are doing, they're just a good way of getting your own name out there. Right? We can all, at some point, use a bit of networking, you know, whether it's the job market or you know, other opportunities that might come our way. Social media, if you follow me on Mastodon, like you'll know very quickly the only things I talk about is the weird stuff that I'm doing and my students. I do talk about my students a lot. I'm very proud of them. But I talk about the weird stuff that I'm doing because this is how other people then go on to talk about right, BSD. I always get students who come to me about maybe 4 or 5 times every year, students I've never met before, just walk into my office and go, are you the OpenBSD developer? Because somehow someone is telling them about what this stuff is. And it drove them enough to see if they had someone on RPI's campus who does this. And you'll very quickly find me if you type in like OpenBSD and RPI. You'll find me pretty quickly. YouTube, I've actually seen a really interesting uptick in people making YouTube videos about the BSDs, predominantly FreeBSD, but that's okay, I'll take it. If YouTube is your thing, do that. Nice bug meetings or any bug meetings, if you've never done one of these things before, start here. There have been so many people who have gotten their start talking at Nice Bug who have gone on to like the bigger BSD conferences or other you know big conferences. Like let this be an incubator for how do I talk about these really interesting and weird and fun things that I'm doing with the BSDs in a way that get other people to say, I have no idea what I just spent the last hour or so listening to, but that sounded cool, I wanna do something like that. And maybe then I can tell someone else about those cool things and get that, you know, get the BSD name out there, I suppose. So I've been talking for about 45 minutes. I think that's probably a good place to wrap everything up. If you take nothing away from this talk, other than I clearly need to find more hobbies and something else to do with my time, it is about, right, none of the things that other people think about the BSDs, particularly the thing about something that we can't do, it's almost never technical. It's social. So get out there and show them that those technical things that they have in their mind aren't true. And with that, we can build a more robust computing environment that we're not worried about the next CrowdStrike or the next insert, whatever the next big attack is going to be. We can build that robust, at least in the operating system world, that robust ecosystem that is not a monoculture, which ultimately, besides being fun, ends up protecting all of us. And I think that's why I'm doing what I'm doing. So with that, thank you everyone for listening to me. I hope this was kind of interesting. I hope you learned something. I'm happy to receive many questions of why do you do what you do, whether it's in person or over IRC. It's all good. Yes?
Continuing on your distinction between the technical and the social reasons, impediments, you chose to do this on FreeBSD rather than OpenBSD.
Yes.
Could you elaborate as to what technical and what social reasons led you not to first do this on the OpenBSD operating system?
So I was really hoping you weren't going to ask this, because on OpenBSD there's a technical reason. OpenBSD does not have a Linux compat layer. That was removed, someone's going to correct me, but I want to say 6 or 7 years ago. So that's the reason. Someone could come by and rebuild the Linux compat layer, but that has not happened yet, and I am not smart enough to do it. So, but FreeBSD, you know, I didn't talk too much about NetBSD, but this does all work on NetBSD. I did try it out on NetBSD with their Linux compat layer. So that was really the reason. Less social, more technical. Yes?
Do you have any thoughts on the Cosmopolitan C compiler?
What's her name? I've talked to her
Justine.
I've talked to her a couple of times. Justine, right. I have gotten it to work on OpenBSD a long time ago, and then I forgot about it. I think, for those of you who don't know, the Cosmopolitan C compiler is designed to be a compilation system that you could compile once on any system and then run the binaries on any other system. And like, she's looking at a huge scope, anything from like Windows to Linux to Mac OS. It's just supposed to work. You compile it once anywhere, and it runs anywhere. That is a very tempting, for me at least, that's a very tempting proposition. Like I said, I've gotten it to work. I haven't really experimented too much with it. It's been a few years since I've spoken to her.
Compile binaries that work on lots of different operations.
Yeah, so like you can compile the binary on OpenBSD, drop in a Windows.
Java.
That is called Java. But you can write it in C. See, that's the difference. You can write it in C.
This big.
Yes.
This much RAM.
I was thinking of making a snide remark.
Maybe it's a sort of snide remark.
Yeah, there's Java, there's all of your scripting languages, right? You know, we just use Python for everything. Yes?
I have a question about software stacks.
Sure.
somewhere in this long thing, whether it was BSD or Solaris or Linux, matters less. And what it's running in the higher layers is basically the same regardless of the OS. It could be running on Windows, or it could be running on whatever. And so you end up with a diverse basis. The roots are diverse, but everything above. It's like it has been like plants, you know, you stick the nice rows on top of something else. Up there, it's all one ecosystem.
Yes, up there it is all one ecosystem. But at some point, it does have to rely on something that is there, right? Whether it's Windows or Linux, or there's something running there.
Right,
if you go deep enough.
Yeah.
I don't know, Microsoft came out, I don't know, 3 weeks ago and said that Linux is the largest OS running on Azure these days. It had surpassed Windows. I still think, you know, even if most people live in these layers where what's underneath ultimately doesn't matter, it doesn't necessarily mean that they are immune to problems that go on at lower layers, right? Think about like any cloud system, right? If the data center goes down or there's some sort of emergency maintenance, all that upper level stuff may still get affected. So I do think it is still worth thinking, for those of us who are going to think about it, and I realize that's not everyone, or even perhaps not most people, but for those of us who do, I still think it's worth it because we still want to isolate any potential problems and protect people from any potential problems, even if they don't know about those lower levels, even if they don't know that that's a problem that could, in fact, you know, cause issues where they live all the way up here. I still think there's value. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
One of the points you made earlier about doing esoteric things, I mean, there's two sides to that, right? It's people who do stupid esoteric weird things that nobody cares about, and then people who are looking for stupid esoteric answers and they think no one's worked on it.
Mm-hmm.
And it comes up. I mean, I'll say this, things I've been involved in a long time ago that I thought had no impact whatsoever that still come up in conversation. People go, oh, were you part of that? And I'm a little shocked because there was no marketing campaign. I wasn't, you know, cribs on Twitter, you know. But I think there's a lot of validity to that because especially in research land, especially when people are trying to solve really odd, specific, weird, narrow problems, there's always people looking for these search strings which are very, very weird. I mean, hopefully with, you know, the dawn of Gen AI, this could be a lot easier to find and decipher. You would think that these stupid, esoteric, you know, things that people do at home and, you know, professors when they're bored, do that, that it would become more accessible to people instead of actually diving through tomes of you know, Bell Labs manuals from the 70s to try to find something that maybe somebody worked on this problem. But, you know, I like to think that, you know, that passion that's driving people to do it and consume this time, you know, it's not compensated, that no one's looking at, that no one cares about, that no one will ever give you credit for. There's nothing more satisfying than finding someone down the road going, oh.
Yeah, so actually I have a very, it's funny you bring that up. It's not BSD related, it's actually amateur radio related. So at RPI, I'm the station trustee and faculty advisor for W2SZ, which is our amateur radio station. And when I had taken over, you know, we were really struggling to find more students interested in amateur radio. A lot of it has been taken over by the maker movement, right? Why go out and get an amateur radio license to build stuff when you can just be part of the maker movement and build things? So I had written a couple of articles for QEX, which is the kind of amateur radio research journal. Not anything super complex, just like, hey, students, did you know that you don't have to just run around with like handy talkies all the time? Like, you can do interesting stuff with amateur radio. And the first thing I ever got published was, could we take like the Intel hex record and Motorola S record format and adapt that in a way that we could send binary transmissions over Morse code? And turns out you can. It's very simple. And like, I can explain it in 5 minutes. I'm not going to, but like, it could be explained in 5 minutes. And just yesterday, I had someone reach out to me and said, could you please send me a copy of that article? I've been doing amateur radio since I was like 12 years old, 60 years ago, and now I'm like, all of a sudden in my retirement, super interested in ways we can kind of misuse Morse code. Yeah. this is all in service of like, hey students, like we can do fun stuff that's not just like talk to each other on like handheld radios. Like we can do like cool stuff. Like we play chess over slow scan TV, our protocol for that. Kind of using steganography to embed player data into the images so that we can actually send side channel stuff. But I do have people to this day who will come and ask me for those things. So, Yes, 1,000%. Let's keep doing the esoteric stuff because it's
really
totally
esoteric.
Worth it.
That
I know.
I am
nothing but nothing if not a stack of strange things that somehow I have a whole career doing and I get paid to do this. It's incredible. Yes.
Your compiler. Do you think that if it were, you know, really polished and available, let's say on FreeBSD, that FreeBSD could itself use this compiler as sort of like an alternate compiler in its own testing and QA process to somehow examine the quality of
with the ICX compiler? Yes, I think that's a real possibility.
The reason I ask that is like 15 years ago when I was involved in a now defunct open source software project, and you know, we back then that C-Lang was just emerging, so basically everybody was using GCC,
mm-hmm.
and once in a while we used G++ to compile the code. And there was one guy who, you know, was in a sort of commercial software place who would test with Intel C compiler, and he made vague noises about how it would reveal things about our code. But of course, nobody had access to that compiler, so we couldn't incorporate it into our testing.
Mm-hmm.
And I was too junior at that point in that project to know anything about the differences between compilers, so I just ignored that subject. Can you speculate as to what it might reveal about kernel?
Well, it clearly reveals something because kernel modules don't work. So whether that's the compiler's problem or FreeBSD's problem, I don't know. I would have to dig into that. But certainly, I would certainly hope, I don't know for sure, not being a FreeBSD developer, I would like to think that someone out there is compiling the kernel in user language GCC every once in a while just to see what's happening. I don't know, but I would like to think that someone is doing that. I'd like to think that someone is doing that for OpenBSD and NetBSD as well. Like at least in OpenBSD land, and I think in FreeBSD land too, it's pretty easy to use the other compiler. It's usually just like an environment variable on your invocation, just like here. So it can be trivially done. Is anyone doing it? And is anyone actually diving into those differences and what they might mean? I don't know. But it would be nice to see for much the same reasons, right? It gives us more kind of diversity in what we're using to make this stuff happen. And I do think that's worthwhile.
I mean, it's the inverse of I have a piece of software and we're running on different operating systems. You know, you're flipping the whole issue around, right? There's lots of times if you're involved in a software project that is ported to multiple operating systems, that same issue comes up. You know, where, oh, you're relying on a bash or in the install, or you're relying on some, you know, GCC extension that's not, you know, or whatever. There's so many different things. That's, I think your point is completely valid. And it's one of the things to me that the BSD is always kind of taking pride in, is to not get all narrow and be portable. And portability was always supposed to be a Unix principle, right? I mean, that's a perfect way to do it, is actually test with all sorts of C compilers.
Yes.
You talked about this cosmopolitan compiler.
Well, the guy behind you did. So
other than a program that's doing calculations or something, I'm just sort of shocked that there could be a world in which you could write something that works on different operating systems when you can't even get more than two people to log on a Microsoft Windows machine to just can't handle it. And it only recently was able to handle more than one. And that kind of thing.
Yeah, so I'm going to be the first to admit
it. There's part of a window and you can't print anything. You can't copy and paste anything. And it's like all over the place. There's these things that are so not working.
Well, the mood light is not so moody anymore. So I'm going to be the first to admit that I don't actually know how she accomplished it. I believe, I could find her website for you. I believe she does talk about like how all those different pieces fit together. I just have not gotten around to actually sitting around and examining. I know it works to some degrees of working. I don't know how complex of code really does truly work across different systems. Like I imagine things that have like windowing or GUI things would open up a whole nother can of worms because right, we have Windows with their GUI system and then Linux and Unix. Now with two, right, you gotta do X and Wayland these days. And then you know Mac OS has its own different system now as well. And right, with the move to the ARM chips, now Metal is their underlying API, I think they call it. They've moved away from Carbon and those other things. So again, I don't know exactly how she did it. I don't know how complex of code actually truly works on that system, but I know it has been done.
I hope my question can be stimulating.
Yeah.
I'm trying to look at it in the opposite way. I'm looking for things that won't work rather than trying to get the thing to work.
Mm-hmm.
And overcoming those sorts of problems. That's, I really enjoyed your talk.
Thank you.
Yeah. That's kind of one thing. And, oh, I have another question.
Go for it.
One question.
Okay, yes.
What's the next compiler you're going to port over?
So here's the thing. And I should probably lead with this. I think I've run out of C compilers. So for those of you who don't know, I maintain separate and not blessed by the OpenBSD project, but I maintain a portable version of the OpenBSD K-shell for other systems. And in that GitHub repo, I have listed every single C compiler that I have gotten to compile successfully, the OpenBSD Corn shell. And I have literally spent time searching the depths of the internet for more C compilers. And I think I've actually run out of C compilers. There are a couple of, I mean, they're old at this point. There's a couple of like Hacker News articles about like these random C compilers you've never heard of. And it's me talking about how I ported these things to OpenBSD. There's one called Lack that's like a one-man operation that he only built to run on Linux. And then I ported it to OpenBSD and gave him the code. And much to my surprise, he actually put it in the repo. There's one called Kefir, like the yogurt drink. That's another one-man project. Same thing, only thought about running on Linux, showed up with like, it works on OpenBSD, here you go. I've ported most of, if not all, of Rui Ueyama, the guy who originally wrote LLD. He's gone on to write the mold linker, which I also ported to OpenBSD. And I also ported the GNU gold linker to OpenBSD. He has a couple of C compilers, ChibiCC, 8cc. I ported those. All those things can build the OpenBSD Corn shell. So if you can find any more, send them my way. That's true. I have not. Okay, you got me there. I've not ported Plan 9 C compiler. I guess that'll be next on my list. But I'm getting there. I'm quickly running out. So.
Get a list from Ori for
me. Yeah, that good. Yeah, that's exactly. Yeah, get a list from Ori for me. Yeah. Yes.
Did you go over C++'s standard pair?
So in terms of the Sun compiler, it basically explodes right away if you try to use its C++ compiler. It turns out its C++ compiler is just an old version of G++. I think it's 5.4. So it's not even really like a unique C++ compiler. In terms of the Intel C++ compiler, as far as I can tell, it's the same thing as the C compiler, indistinguishable in the front end from Clang. So if you can compile the C++ code with Clang++, it will just compile with ICPX.
I only bring up almost specifically standard pair because that last slide you showed about trying to build FreeBSD, even though it's the base system, we don't talk about that. I've run into now I'm trying to update WebKit on FreeBSD.
Mm-hmm. What?
GCC.
What?
Because of a historical, so with FreeBSD's libc++ from LLVM, there's a historical tidbit that we're still using the version 1 ABI. Meanwhile, everything else assumes version 2 ABI, which means there's a different standard pair implementation. And I guess for some reason, WebKit now uses that, and as a result, without like probably a hell of a lot of patching, maybe not, you know, because it's just fundamentally bad. At this point, you probably cannot build WebKit GTK.
So totally out of curiosity, because I do not keep up with FreeBSD Clang versions. What version of Clang is FreeBSD using these days? Like on 14, for example, whatever the latest is. Oh, so FreeBSD would have to actually change the implementation.
Well, it's more that we're going to have to not only bump, we have to bump the ABI version in the base system for the libc++, for the C++ standard library.
Yeah, that happens. We bump library majors all the time. It's normal. It is what it is. You bump a library major, you rebuild all your packages, and you go about your day. That's why we have these really big build farms that are really, really fast and do it for us so that we don't have to think about it. Because I know I, for one, would not like to sit around and rebuild all my packages all day long. I do enough weird stuff. I don't need to sit around and build all my packages from scratch. My favorite command on OpenBSD is package add. I don't want to do it. Someone else did it for me already. It's great. But that is interesting. I did not know that about the standard pair implementation. Interesting.
Early adopters, so we usually adopted version 1 ABI, and then, like, you know, as version 1, and then, like, I guess later on, which upstream LLVM, by the way, they still have not declared version 2 a stable.
Yeah, but why should that stop anyone? Why should stability ever stop someone?
We're still stuck on version 1 because everything, I guess, depends on it, and
except for WebKit.
Dimitri doesn't want to change it until they declare it stable.
Interesting. Huh. Learn something new.
So it's in your OKSH repo on GitHub that has the C compilers.
It just has a laundry list of all the C compilers.
Yeah,
that.
Yeah.
Well, it's not that short either. And considering that if it's on that list, with very small exception, I port it to OpenBSD first.
Okay, there's probably 15 here, 14. And considering how long C has been around, I expect there to be like more frivolous floating.
Well, probably, but they're probably like, you got to pay for them. They might be 20 years old, you know.
Well, PCC is almost getting there.
That's true. Well, you know, you think of like the Edison design group, right? Famous for their C and C++ front end. That's going to be in a number of proprietary compilers. In fact, I think Intel was one of their customers before they switched to Clang. But like, I'm not going to get a hold of their front end anytime soon, so... You know, if I don't stumble upon someone who happens to be using their front end, I'm not going to know. Yes?
Could you talk more about how you decide that it's working, other than, you know, you don't get compiler errors and some program it reaches the end?
Yeah, so how do I decide that?
Thoughts on it?
Yeah, what is working when it comes to a compiler? Well, I mean, for ICX, I think that's a pretty good test. Now, the Sun compiler will not compile the FreeBSD kernel. The headers are just at this point pretty locked on to like GNU and Clang. So that's kind of, unfortunately, out of the question. However, with things like the Sun compiler, you know, how big of a, or how complex of a C project can we build? I tend to use the GNU tools, like they're not just the core utils, but like a lot of GNU packages as a baseline, because those are usually written to be as portable as possible, because again, when these things were being created, they had that problem where like they didn't know what system this was going to be run on. They didn't know what kind of compiler that you would have. They might not even necessarily know what kind of headers you have, right? If you ever take the time to like read through autoconf output, it's searching for like ancient headers sometimes and like really ancient stuff, because they had to live and build this stuff in a world where they legitimately did not know what kind of a mess of a system you might have, right? Back in those days, could be Solaris, could be AIX, could be HPUX, could be Linux, could be a BSD, right? There was a whole lot of just open questions about the system you were on. And so from my perspective, if I can download a good cross-section of GNU software and get it to build and run through a test suite and be approximately on par as to what we would get with GCC or Clang, then I feel pretty good about it. And you know, and the Sun compiler is pretty close to being there. I wouldn't say it's 100% to that level, but I'm routinely surprised with how much it can in fact build. I'll put it that way. For a compiler that's that old and definitely not targeting this OS. But that's kind of my perspective on things. That's where I declare it done. And then other people can surprise me with the interesting software that they build. Or not. Anything else? Cool. Well, as I said before, thank you.
Thank you.
Go out and do these crazy things, and then come talk to us about them. And if you want to get a hold of me, I am both bcala@openbsd.org and bcala@bsd.network for those of you who use Mastodon in the Fediverse. So if you ping me, I'll probably respond.